At the turn of the 19th century, women ventured out into the world to make a difference. Some became famous. Some should have been. This is not the story of a world-class aviatrix, nor a Nobel Prize winner. It is the story of a woman who made every day of her life an art, whose love of people and the spirit in all things changed the world one person at a time, simply by being who she was. Marjorie Eaton was born an artist, destined to live a life of creativity in everything she did. In the second half of her fascinating journey, she enjoyed a 40-year career as an actress, in films, on stage, and on television. But it is her life as a painter. Before Hollywood, living with the Taos Indians and later in Mexico, that molded and shaped her forever.
It's hard for a woman to be a painter. I think it takes a great Rosa Bonheur.
She got everything she needs. She's an artist, but she don't look back.
When Marjorie was 4, her mother died, leaving her to a father consumed with building a career as one of San Francisco's leading surgeons. This abandonment by both her parents became the flame for her independent spirit. Born in 1901, Marjorie's upbringing was decidedly Victorian. She was definitely not. She was driven by an irresistible need to express her unique talents. This burning passion was her guide throughout her life. Having received a classical education at the California School of Fine Arts, she went to Boston, Florence, and Paris to study the new modernism style, Cubism. She was excited by the revolution taking place in modern art and threw herself into her studies abroad.
Had a studio of my own outside of Florence in a chapel and nearly froze to death. After I thawed out, I went into France, which was a great luxury. In southern France, I started to study with André Lhote. He was part of the Cubist movement.
During a brief return to California, Marjorie grew restless and in need of artistic stimulation. Invited by mentor Galka Shire and fellow painter Catherine Scheele to come to Taos, the timing was perfect, and against her father's wishes, she left for the Great Southwest.
And he said, "You know where you're going?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Where is Taos?" I said, "Well, it's on the other side of Palm Springs." And he showed me there was a state in between. That rather surprised me, but that didn't stop me.
What woman, age 27, in 1928, gets in her little car, alone, and makes the long trek to Taos? What was driving her? What made her know she had to go?
I went out one night with my friend and heard them on the bridge. The young men would sing. They were all wrapped in their white sheets. You could only see eyes and little cigarettes moving in the dark, and beat a drum. My heart that night was beating that drum beat. I saw this beautiful Indian and I said to Katie, "I've seen an extraordinary face. It looks like a Leonardo da Vinci."
Marjorie had found her muse. Juan became the inspiration for many of her finest paintings. The magnetism between them was irresistible, and they became lovers. This passionate relationship with the son of the Taos chief was to be the enduring love of her life. Their powerful affair lasted 3 years, but could not overcome the conventions of the day and Juan's responsibility to the tribe. Their multiracial relationship held too many sacrifices for both of them. Heartbroken, she returned to California with her paintings.
I think he remained with her whole life. I mean, she would sometimes be interested, even as an older woman, in some men, but it was one that she missed.
She was someone who planted herself in Taos. Her very distinctly modernist, cubist-oriented style stood out from most of the other people who were there.
When she left Taos and went to New York City and lived in a flat in the same building with Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo, that period of time was amazing for her.
Marjorie sought out the movers and shakers of the 1920s and 30s in the world of art and architecture. These luminaries and legends were often drawn to her for her passion and charisma. She was intoxicating to be around, a bright star in an artistic galaxy when the world was saying yes to the avant-garde.
In essence, she was one of the major cross-pollinators in the arts.
So Marjorie was basically paying the rent for the three of them. And they went out a great deal, almost every night to dinner, and they were quite liberal in the alcohol department. They had a wonderful time.
While in New York, Marjorie studied with Hans Hofmann at the Art Students League and at night with Arshil Gorky. She and her friends, sculptors Louise Nevelson, Diego Rivera, and Frida Kahlo, among many others, were at the heart of the New York art scene in the early 30s. During her time in New York, she was offered a show at the Legion of Honor in San Francisco. This exhibit was highly significant for her, and she was positioned to be a very famous painter.
Well, I was really going to Europe to meet Paul Klee and Kandinsky, and Jablonski had letters to them. And Hitler came into power in 33, and nobody was going then, you know. I knew Diego Rivera already. I introduced him to Louise, and he invited me to come to Mexico to work with him there. So I did go to Mexico, and I spent 3 years there.
Marjorie's father died suddenly during her first year in Mexico, thus ending any hope of healing their troubled relationship.
So she was always in defiance, and I think she felt guilty about that, and it was something between them that was very difficult.
Marjorie needed solitude and reflection, and she had ventured into the unknown as the only gringo in a remote Mexican village.
I went away to an obscure village, Powhatlan, in the Huasteca country, and I lived a year there with the natives and the very poor people and the Indians, the Aztecs that came from the mountains for the market day.
While there, she photographed hundreds of images of the people and local life for painting studies. After a year, she needed to make a decision whether to come back to California or stay in Mexico.
I wept. I hated to leave Mexico. In fact, I had already taken out the papers to become a Mexican citizen. I was so unhappy about it. I thought I must get into something creative and at the same time not. Well, I didn't know whether I was important enough to indulge myself.
Ironically, Marjorie never painted again. For the rest of her life, she made her living as an actress, making her last film at age 84.
Yes?
But it is her paintings that express her most inner and personal self. The images invite us to be with her and with the people whose lives she interpreted. Perhaps this eccentric, vastly talented woman reminds us how to listen, to be true to ourselves. One thing for sure, Marjorie did not allow the rules of the day to stop her. Ever.
She simply was a remarkable human being.
Marjorie is timeless. There's no beginning, no ending for me.
Her life is a beacon of light, a beckoning to the creative in all of us.
Try not to stop. There's something stops you.